Very warm welcome to all of you in today's video lecture on strength of materials. Today we will learn about tension, compression and shear. Okay, this chapter I will say you that you learn by heart. You try to understand each and everything. You go into the details for this particular chapter because this chapter will form the foundation for many other chapters in strength of materials. You will be able to feel its importance once we proceed. Suppose there is a prismatic bar. You know what is prismatic bar? Prismatic bar means bar with uniform cross section. We are applying tensile load. This is x axis, suppose. We are applying the load along x axis. Today we will deal with only uniaxial things and it will only take lot of time. We will deal with biaxial and triaxial in other video lectures. Okay, but for now please understand this uniaxial loading in complete detail. Okay, this is the loading condition. If I ask you that what is the stress induced in this bar, and suppose you answer stress induced, sigma induced equals to P by A, and I will ask you what is A, you will say A is the cross sectional area. If you see the side view, this is the cross sectional area A, or you can say A CS also. Okay, very good. But my dear friend, you have given me the answer of this stress that is induced at a cross sectional plane. At any given cross section, the stress induced is this. Suppose if I cut the bar from this cross section, then this will be sigma times A. S equals to sigma times A, where S and P are same. So sigma equals to P by A. That is the thing. You have given me the answer for stress induced at a cross sectional plane. But if I ask you that I don't want to know about the stress induced at cross sectional plane, can you tell me what is the stress induced for this condition, say, suppose? This was your loading diagram. This is the way you load. Now, can you tell me the stress that is induced at this inclined plane? Previously, you have said what is the stress induced somewhere at this cross-sectional plane. But now I want to know that what is the stress that is induced at this inclined plane. Can you tell me? For that, we have to derive a formula. We will derive a general equation where if we put the values of phi, I will tell you what is phi, then you will be able to find the stress that is induced at any plane which is oriented at any inclination. Okay, so let's proceed. Suppose now we have to define some angle phi, that means its inclination. Now suppose this was your x axis and in this direction y axis, in this direction coming out of the board it is z axis. I'm not drawing those things because those axis reference are not needed now. Okay, now we will draw a normal to the surface where you want to find the stress induced.
Normal.
This is the normal vector to this surface. Normal vector. You can see that this angle is 90 degree. I'm not drawing it. This is your plane. This is your normal. This angle is 90 degree. Okay. Now, your phi will be this angle. The angle of the normal coming out of the plane and the x-axis, that we will define as beautiful phi. Is it clear or not? Now we will derive our formula with respect to this figure. Is it clear? Now things are very simple. The way you have said that the sigma at a cross-sectional plane is nothing but the force that is acting at a cross-sectional plane. At each cross-section, the force acting will be P only divided by the area of the cross-sectional plane, that is A or ACS, whichever thing you write. Similarly, to know the stress over here, you want to know the force upon area. So what is the force that is acting over here? Can we transmit this force P over here due to transmissibility of the transmissibility of force principle? So this is my force which was acting along x-axis. This is P. Is it clear? Now, my dear friend, can I break this P into two components? One will be P cos phi component and another will be P sin phi component. Is it clear? Because this angle is phi. Simple thing. So P cos phi, it is the normal force. It is the normal force acting on the surface or acting on the plane. When I am writing plane, that means I am talking about this inclined plane, that where I want to find my stresses. Okay. P sin phi is nothing but the tangential force. P sin phi is the tangential force acting on this plane. I hope these things are very clear to you. Now, one thing you will be able to guess, normal force will result in normal stress, tangential force will result in, give rise to tangential stress. That's it. So, I can write sigma normal is equals to normal force divided by the area on which the normal force is acting. Is it clear? The normal force divided by the area on which the normal force is acting. This normal force is nothing but P cos phi divided by the area on which the normal force is acting is A prime. It is A dashed. A dashed is this area of this plane. Okay. The cross sectional area we denote with A, and this area of this plane we are writing with A dashed. In case you are having difficulty in understanding that what is A dash, then see the three-dimensional view. Things will become very easy for you. This is your bar. You are loading it like that. Okay, we are talking about three-dimensional view. Is it clear? We want to find the area of this surface. Okay. And I am calling this area as A dashed. Is it clear to you or not? Let us see what is the value of A dashed. Get back. I don't want to make this picture look clumsy, so I am drawing another two-dimensional view over here. So you, this is your A dashed, and this is your cross-sectional plane whose area is A. Is it clear? Now this was your normal. This is your x-axis. With x-axis, your normal make an angle phi. Okay, if this angle is phi, then this angle, it is visible to you? Yes, wait, let me make it little bit bigger. This area is A dashed. The cross-sectional plane, this is area is A. The normal, this is your x-axis, this angle was phi. If this angle is phi, then this is 90 minus phi. If this is 90 minus phi, then this is 90 minus phi. Alternate angles, this was 90 degrees, so this angle is phi. Okay, so this angle is phi again. Is it clear to you or not? I want to derive one relation, that's why I am showing you this. Okay, this angle is phi. Now, can I write cos phi? It is base by hypotenuse. What is your base? This is angle is phi. So base is A, hypotenuse is A dash. So I can write A dashed as A divided by cos phi. Is it clear? This area I am writing in terms of the cross sectional area. So A dashed. So I can write P cos phi divided by A dashed is nothing but A cos phi. Now I can write P by A cos square phi. That's it. So normal stress at any plane you will be able to find. You put the values of phi, different values of phi, you will be able to find the normal stresses in those planes. You put phi as 0. Phi as 0 indicates this cross-sectional plane, because for any cross-sectional plane you choose, suppose for this cross-sectional plane, its normal is like this, which is making 0 degree angle with x-axis, because it is coaxial with x-axis. So, if you put phi as 0 in this case, suppose phi as 0 if you put, then cos 0 is 0, so cos 0 is 1, so sigma normal equals to P by A. So, that's what we were discussing, that sigma induced at any cross-sectional plane was P by A. Normal stress at any cross-sectional plane was P by A. Let us see that what is the concept of tangential stress and what is the tangential stress at cross-sectional plane. We will see different cases, don't worry. First, let us derive the equation. Okay, we will see different cases. We will be able to see that how things are going to fail. Things will become very interesting, don't worry. So, we have seen two things. that is A dashed is equals to A by cos phi, and your sigma normal stress is nothing but P by A cos square phi. These two things we know. Now let us see what is the concept for tau. Tau, shear stress or tangential stress, it is nothing but tangential force divided by the area on which the tangential force is acting. Is it clear? So tangential force is nothing but your P sine phi divided by what is the area on which it is acting. This tangential force is also acting on A dashed. So you can write P sine phi divided by A dashed is nothing but A by cos phi. So you can write P by A sine phi cos phi. P by A sine phi cos phi. It is not visible to you. Wait, let me erase this portion. So you can write directly it as P by A sine phi cos phi. So if you multiply 2 on both sides, you will get P 2P sine phi cos phi divided by 2A. So you can write it P by 2A sine 2 phi. P by 2A sine 2 phi. That's it. You put different values of phi. If you put phi as 0 degree, then sine 0, 0, tau is equal to 0. That means the shear stress at any cross-sectional plane is 0. The shear stress that is acting at any cross-sectional plane is 0. We will see for different cases, don't worry. Now, if you have a confusion that why this tangential area on which the tangential force is acting is considered as A dash, in case you have this problem, see the three-dimensional view. This is your plane. On this plane, shear stresses will be acting like this. Is it clear? That's why we have written A dash. And on the same plane, normal stresses will act like this. This is our plane. Normal stresses will be like this. Normal to the surface. Is it clear? We can represent these shear stress and normal stress on the same diagram, but to avoid the clumsiness, I have drawn two separate diagrams. Both are acting on this A dashed plane. Okay, that's why the area we have chosen as A dashed. Is it clear to you? Very good. So, remember two formulas that we have derived. Sigma normal is equals to P by A cos square phi. Tau is equals to P by 2A sine 2 phi. Is it clear? Now, one important thing that I want to tell you over here is that if I show you the stress representation on this plane, particular plane, if I show you the stress representation, then this is sigma normal and this is your shear stress tau acting. Okay? If my tau or if my shear stress is acting downwards or my shear stress is acting in such a manner that it is trying to rotate some element in the center in clockwise direction, then we will consider it as positive shear. This is positive shear. If my this is the plane, suppose if my shear stress is acting in this manner, then as the, about the, this point in the center, the shear stress is trying to rotate in the anti-clockwise direction, which we call as negative shear stress. This is just the sign convention that we are considering. Let me tell you that I follow the book of Timoshenko. Timoshenko follows this representation. If you see other books of strength of materials like G.R. Goodnow, they might follow this representation. I think that if your shear stress is rotating some element inside in the anti-clockwise direction, that they have considered as positive, but we will consider negative, and we will get same results. Okay, there will be no difference in result. There is one condition, that you stick to the thing that you are learning. Okay, don't switch here and there. If you are willing to learn from any other source, stick to that. Okay, so when we were deriving our tau was acting due to this P sine phi force, the shear stress will be acting downwards, so it's a positive shear. Okay, now we are moving into little bit interesting things. See why we have derived these two formulas, P by A cos square phi and tau equals to P by 2A sin 2 phi. With the help of these two formulas, we will be able to know that due to this uniaxial load, some normal stress and shear stress is definitely induced at different planes. But at which plane the normal stress is maximum? At which plane the shear stress is maximum? Those planes will be our special source of interest. Or I must say, those planes will be our special point of interest. We have loaded our bar just by simple tension. But we have seen that inside there are various planes where shear stress and normal stress both are going to be induced. But where these things are maximum, that is our interest. First of all, you put phi is equals to 0. If you put phi as 0, then you will get sigma normal maximum. That means that its value will be cos 0, 0. So cos 0 is 1, so P by A. So maximum normal stress value is P by A. Whichever force you are applying, you divide with the cross-sectional area. That is the maximum normal stress value. And normal stress will be maximum at which point? At phi is equals to 0 planes. All the cross-sectional planes, these are phi is equals to 0 planes, because their normal is coinciding with the x-axis. Is it clear? So phi is equals to 0 planes, or the cross-sectional planes, in these cases, in this uniaxial loading condition, are the planes where the normal stress is maximum. Is it clear to you or not? So they are often called as major principal plane. I could have introduced you with major principal plane and minor principal plane, principal stresses now, but I will introduce you with that in biaxial stress conditions. For now, time being, we will understand about failures, how things will fail. You will be able to understand. See, okay, at phi is equals to 0, what is the value of tau? Tau is equals to 0, phi sine 0, 0. That means the shear stress that is acting on all these cross-sectional planes is zero. Okay. So when phi is zero, then normal stress becomes quite important because it is maximum. Okay. Now, at phi is equals to 45 degree, what is your tau? Can you tell me that tau will be tau max? No doubt in that, because this function will be having maximum value when phi is 45 degree. That means it will be sine 90, so tau max will be P by 2A value. Is it clear? So, all the planes whose normal makes 45 degree with the x-axis, those are also quite important planes, because those planes are planes where shear stress is maximum. Is it clear? Let me erase all these cross-sectional planes. Now, inside this bar, there are many planes whose normal are infinite number of planes whose normal is making angle of 45 degree with x-axis. Let me choose any one plane like that. This is its normal. This is the x-axis. This angle is 45 degree. Along this plane, whatever shear stress that is acting, it is having the maximum value. You can write that shear stress along this plane is having maximum value. There may be other planes at phi is equals to 30 degree, phi is equals to 50 degree, phi equals 70 degree, but phi is equals to 45 degree plane, shear stress will be maximum. I will tell you it's about its importance. You will be able to see the beauty more. Can you tell me what is the principal stress at phi equals to 45 degree? Cos 45 degree is 1 by root 2, so sigma normal will also be P by 2. 1 by root 2, yes, that's correct. So normal stress at phi is equals to 45 degree planes, there is also normal stress, which is whose value is P by 2A, and tau maximum value is also P by 2A. But this normal stress is not so important in these planes, because normal stress is maximum somewhere else. That means all in the cross-sectional planes, the normal stress is maximum. In phi equals to 45 degree, tau max, shear stress is maximum. Sir, I'm not getting what you want to tell. Please say clearly, okay? Let me say clearly. Suppose you are choosing a material which is weak under shear. My dear friend, for those materials, phi is equals to 45 degree planes will be very, very important. Because those materials will not be failing due to these normal stresses. Those materials will fail where shear will be maximum. Because I have told you, you are choosing a material which is weak under shear. Like mild steel. Is it clear? If you choose a brittle material, suppose a chalk. Let's see what happens. See, this chalk is a brittle material. It is not prismatic. Because you can see that its cross-section is not uniform. It is something trapezoidal. Okay. But still, we will get results very close to our knowledge. This is brittle material.
Brittle materials are weak under tension. That means brittle materials are weak under normal stresses. So, if I apply some tensile load, this chalk must fail from any of its cross section. It must fail along any cross section, because at cross sectional planes, phi equals to 0, sigma normal is having maximum value. See, let's see whether we get result quite close to that or not. You have seen that it has failed across a cross section. You can see this is a cross section. You can see this. It has failed at a cross section. I told you results will not be exactly same because this chalk was not prismatic. Let me take this chalk, which is little bit more prismatic. Let me apply tensile load. I am applying this four load very slowly. Let me see whether it breaks. See, this result is more close to what our analytical expressions say, that this is a brittle material and it must fail through any of its cross section. There are numerous cross sections as you move from here. This is one cross section, the infinite cross section. It fails through this. Okay? But suppose if I apply torsion, this failure is not taking place through the cross section. This failure is taking place at some plane which is like this. We will see the torsional failure case also when I will teach you torsion. But definitely you can see the difference, that here the failure is not taking place through the cross sectional plane. Its plane is something, the failure is taking place at some inclined plane like this. How much angle, I will tell you later on. Okay? So, if I have a mild steel, definitely with a universal testing machine, you would have seen the failure of mild steel also, which is a ductile material. Tau max, phi is equal to 45 degree. I will show you while explaining. That I cannot explain with practical demonstration.
So, before moving into mild steel, let us understand this example first. Suppose this is a wooden post, okay? This material is wood. These are just lines, marks on wood. Now, you are applying compressive load equally, which is along the x-axis. This is a uniaxial loading condition. Now, you have to analyze what is happening. Suppose you are performing this experiment. When you are increasing this value of P slowly, what happens is that at some point of time, this material fails in this manner. Okay. This is the way this material will fail along a jagged plane. Okay. This is a jagged plane. This material is going to fail. Now what I am trying to say you is that you suppose this is the plane you are choosing. You draw normal to this plane. This is your x-axis. This is where load is applied. Now you measure this angle. You will find your result quite close to 45 degrees. Whenever you are seeing this result, you are now quite sure that this wooden post, although you are applying compressive load, that is normal load, but it is not failing due to the normal stress that is induced. There are planes where normal stress are induced. In this 45 degree plane also there is normal stress, but maximum normal stress is in the cross sectional planes, but it has not failed through any of its cross section. This material, this wooden post, has not failed in this way. It has not failed along this way. Okay, that is phi is equals to zero plane or cross sectional plane. That means normal stress is not responsible for the failure of this material. We have seen that phi is equals to 45 degree means it's a plane where shear stress is maximum. That means you are able to know that although you are applying compressive load in this wooden post is failing due to shear. That due to maximum shear stress. It is failing along a plane where shear stress is maximum. That means this wooden post is weak under shear. Is it clear? This wooden post is quite strong under normal stress, but it is weak under shear. See, we know that tau formula, it is visible to you. Yes, tau formula, it is nothing but P by 2A sine 2 phi. Is it clear? Now, we have derived this from tensile loading. Remember this. Now, let me erase this drawings. Now, phi is 45 degree. In case of P, we will put minus P because the load is compressive in nature. Now, you are getting tau equals to minus P by 2A sine 90 degree. That means your result is tau equals to minus of P by 2A. Minus of P by 2A. That means shear stress is negative. Shear stress negative means upward direction. Trying to rotate the element inside in counterclockwise direction. See what is happening. This was your wooden post. You are applying compressive load. Okay. This is the plane. It's normal. It's making an angle of phi is equals to 45 degree. Now this is the compressive, let me draw with black. This is the compressive load, okay. Now if you bring this compressive load over here, this is P, then you can break it into two components. One is this tangential component and this normal component. Okay, is it clear? Let me show you more clearly. Don't worry, everything will be clear to you. This is the thing. So what is happening due to this P compressive load? This normal stress, which is compressive in nature, is developed here, and another is this shear stress. This is sigma compressive, which is normal stress. You can also write over here sigma n. Okay, and this will be tau. Remember that this shear stress is negative. We don't use minus or plus over here because it is already indicating negative shear, because shear is upwards. You see, suppose any point inside this, this shear stress is trying to rotate it about this point in anticlockwise direction. That's why it is negative. Okay, that's why you got negative sign. That's it. So, you have understood, in case of failure of a chalk, I showed you that the failure took place like that. This was the chalk piece, and I have applied tensile force, and the failure took place about any normal section. Okay, somewhere over here, suppose the failure took place like that. That means this chalk is not weak under shear. This chalk is weak under normal stresses because this is made of brittle material.
Is it clear to you or not?
I'm tired of explaining this.